that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed wherever I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread, or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or floor below but makes thy glories known. And clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne. Creatures that borrow life from thee are subject to thy care. There's not a place where we can flee, but God is present there.
Our next item is number 327. 327. And that states what? I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. Rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's transfer. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
We're going to do 654 in the old hymnal. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome. Blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome. Blessed Sabbath day. Holy day, Jehovah's rest, of creation's week the best. Last of all the chosen Sabbath, blessed of God, man was given.
Holy day, Jehovah's rest, of creation's week the best, last of all the chosen Sabbath, blessed of God to man 'twas given.
Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe, it will joy and comfort give you. Take it then where'er you go. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then wherever you go. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet.
Pleasant good morning to our GNCC members and friends, both here in the midst and online. Good morning. It's an absolute joy to welcome you to our Sabbath school today, and it's my prayer that you're truly blessed. We're going to have our opening prayer now.
Good morning. Let's stand. Heavenly Father, Lord, this morning we want to just give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor that is due to your matchless name. Father, dear God, we want to thank you, dear God, for the blessings of the week. Some may have had turbulent times, but dear God, we want to thank you for being able to be here to worship and to honor your name. Father, as we go through this type of school, may it be a means of blessing someone somewhere, dear God, that they may come to call your name blessed. Continue to be with us continue to give us divine intervention, dear God, with your Holy Spirit. Be with us now, dear God, as my friend, he's asking for prayer, dear God, for his goddaughter, who is currently going through a turbulent time there in the hospital with having blood into her lungs and stuff like that. I'm asking, dear God, for healing. We're asking, dear God, this morning for healing for that. I pray to God that you will continue to heal those who we know can be healed once it is your will, and continue to be with us as we go through this day. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. Now, Sabbath school this morning is going to be a little bit different. And that's because I'll require one big thing. Your participation. Repeat that for me. One more time. Thank you, Gio. Our theme for this morning is, Oh, How He Loves Us. And there will be an opportunity for two short testimonies as the program continues. Now, it's no secret that our Father in Heaven loves us unconditionally. And I'd like to believe this is something that we're all well aware of. But how do we know that He loves us? There's a beautiful little chorus that we often sing, and it says, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong. They are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. You heard that? The Bible tells us that Jesus loves us. And you know what? There's a hymn that says it too. It says, I am so glad that our Father in Heaven tells of His love in the book He has given. Wonderful things in the Bible, they see. This is the dearest that Jesus loves me. Isn't that beautiful? Jesus loves me. Now, there are a couple places in the Bible that we can find that Jesus does in fact love us. I'd like someone to look for Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 and 23. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 and 23. And read it, please. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 and 23. Great is thy faithfulness. We can even look further and look into Psalm chapter 63, verse 3. Somebody else with Psalm chapter 63, verse 3, please. Thank you. Isn't that incredible? Jesus loving the little ones like me, and Jesus loving the older ones like you. Now, if you're anything like me, telling me something and showing me something are two very different things. But let's think about it. Now, I know my mommy loves me. She tells me she does, and she shows me she does. And I know my daddy loves me. He tells me he does, and he shows me he does. But those are my parents, and realistically, they don't really have a choice. So, let's look a little deeper. What has God done to show you that He loves you? Any two people, two testimonies. Anyone else? No, this is my testimony. It's always been easy for me to believe that God loves the world and he loves his people and that Jesus loves his church. But sometimes when life was a bit too hard on this soldier, I just couldn't find a reason why or even how he could love me. However, after some deep thinking, I realized there's no reason why he wouldn't. In looking past myself and looking more at Jesus, it's clear that he is love. Love is the entirety of his being. Love is his life. Love is the reason that he lives. And because he lives, he loves me. Worthy or unworthy, he's going to love me. And it's so easy to say that he woke me up this morning and I got some clothes on my back and shoes on my feet. But God has held my fisted, stubborn hand on many occasions. And the Holy Spirit would whisper his guiding words, and I'll remember my Jesus up on that cross, bleeding and dying, and yet still he loved me. That, my friends, is love. We'll now join our voices as we sing number 183, I Will Sing of Jesus' Love.
Favorite songs. I will sing of Jesus' love. Our mission feature today, our mission story, is entitled Pastor or Politician. This quarter's mission stories come from the East Central African Division, and today's mission story is brought to us from the beautiful country of Tanzania. It's about a young man, his name was Jacob. And Jacob said he felt the calling of God on his life when he was age 7. He decided at that age that he wanted to be a pastor. But as he got older, as a teen and into his early 20s, he was under a lot of pressure from politicians to join their party because they were saying he has all the characteristics and he's intelligent and all these other things that they thought would make an excellent politician. And the truth is, Jacob couldn't seem to find the money to pursue theology studies at the University of Arusha, which is the only Seventh-day Adventist university that offers pastoral training in Tanzania. He needed a lot of money to cover tuition fees, accommodation, and food. And he really had no hope of qualifying for a government financial aid or for a scholarship. So Jacob said he decided that he was going to test God. He said from the little jobs he had been faithful in returning his tithes and his offerings. And he said Malachi 3:10 was ringing in his ears. And he said, the text says, bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing such that you wouldn't even have enough room to receive it. So Jacob said his prayer was, Lord, I'm waiting for a call. Whoever call me first, that is where I'm going. So if I get the politician call first, I will be a politician. If I get the pastor call first, I will be a pastor. But we know how God works. No sooner had Jacob got up from his knees than he got a call from a district pastor to come and preach at the church, at his church the following Sabbath. And Jacob accepted the invitation. He said that after preaching that Sabbath, he was so moved to hear the church members, including the pastor, praising God because of the message. And after that, he began to get regular calls to preach at various churches. And then he was invited to work as the associate chaplain at an elementary school. Now, after doing this for some time, he said he felt impressed to step aside from his work as an associate chaplain and establish a media and IT company. He said he asked God to use that company to help him to get to study theology. His prayer, he said, was, God, I see that you are calling me to ministry. Please give me the assurance of being able to pay my tuition and accommodation fees at the university. You can probably tell me the next part, because God came through for him again. He said not only did the media company start to make money, but suddenly friends and different people were just sending him donations. Then he was called to serve as an associate pastor of a church near the university campus. He said it was an unusual call because in Tanzania, the only people that serve as pastors or associate pastors are people with theology qualifications, and he didn't have any yet. So he accepted the call and enrolled at the university. Now today, at this time in 2023, Jacob is wrapping up his studies at the university. His preaching already has had an impact on a lot of young people. A series of sermons that he prepared on practical faith was so well received that he is developing them into a book. And as he looks back, he says he has no doubt that God called him to gospel ministry at the age of 7. He says, the series of miracles that have happened to me prove that God called me when I was young. And this testifies to the fact that God calls people from childhood, even now in this age in which we are living, as he did in ancient times. We are told that this quarter's 13th Sabbath offering will help to expand the University of Arusha with the construction of a multipurpose hall, part of which will house the theology department and classrooms for ministerial training. And so Jacob and all others in the East Central African Division are saying thank you for the 13th Sabbath offering which you are going to give. At this time, I invite you to stand as we pray for the lesson study. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the blessings that we receive through the study of your word. I pray now that as we go into our lesson study, planning for success, I pray, dear Lord, that you would help us that what we study throughout the week will come back to our minds so that we can have a fruitful and interesting discussion. Most of all, I pray that what we study today will help to draw each and every one of us closer to you. So bless us as we wait upon you, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. The church is now at study.
A pleasant Sabbath to one and all. For those of you visiting with us and who have children, the children Sabbath school is over in the round house. So 16 years and under, they're waiting for you over there. We also have a youth class, so if they're 16 and above, they can join the youth classes. We want our visitors and our children to be part of our study. So we're asking all children, parents, if you're visiting with us, you can let them go. They will be well taken care of, and then you can come back over for the comeback. So at this time, let the children go. The aunties and uncles are waiting there to take them over. Thank you so kindly for your compliance.
Just kidding. You join the classes.
I want to say good morning I think we're still in the house. Yes, I want to say. Okay, while the technicians are getting things sorted out, this is our caring and sharing time. We have been divided into action units, and each person within the class has a specific responsibility. There are persons who've got responsibility for making sure the members study during the week. The individuals who have responsibility for the social activity. Then there are those who mark the register. Then we have the first session is caring and sharing. That is where. Okay, to those of you online, we are thankful that you're joining us this morning. My class, the name is Emmanuel. God is with us. And we invite you to our lesson study. We're going to have our caring and sharing session at this time. Any of you members, is anything that you want to share this week that you want the class to know? I had an interesting experience and I'll share it with you later, but who wants to be first? Anything that you went through this week that you want to share with the church?
This week.
You went through this week? Yeah. But nothing you want to share? Okay. All right. My brother is saying that he is pleased that he made it through the week. And all of us can say that. Amen? Had it not been for the mercies of God, we would not be here. Okay. So God took us through the week. This week, I'll share my experience then. I went into the field with two of our Bible workers into the area called Harlington. And I made some contact there with individuals. And those guys have been working in that field for about a month or so. And they have really made serious inroads based on my observations. I went in, and in fact, I can tell you now, there are individuals in church today from that community. Say amen to that. And like I said, they were very receptive. They want Bible study. In fact, one of our members who live in that area, he said he met a guy yesterday at the supermarket. And the guy told him he wants to come to church today, and he also wants to be part of the Bible study class that they're planning. So that would be my caring and sharing. I had the opportunity to see the work that the guys have gone and done before being fruitful. So that would be my sharing. Anyone else want to share before we move in to our study?
I had two experiences this week. One of my neighbors have a twin. And based on my understanding, because I am an Adventist and she know I'm a Christian, she want to offer up these two children. They but only a couple more, near 2 months. But she so entrusted me with children. You know me and children, I really love children. And day before yesterday, me and she had an encounter and she said she want to offer up these children. So I told her I would talk to the pastor and stuff and get these two children offer up. So yesterday we made the arrangement. I got the paper here to bring to the pastor to offer up these children for next Sabbath, once God spare life, next Sabbath. So it's a twin, it's going to be offer up, and then they're going to start coming to the church, the mother and the two children from next Sabbath.
When our sister say offer up there, we're not offering them as sacrifices. She may be going to have them blessed. You might be a bit concerned out there. In the Adventist church, we don't baptize children. We don't sprinkle them. They haven't reached the point where they can determine whether to be baptized or not. So what we do, we bless them as Jesus Christ did. So the sister, when she said, offer them up, she's saying that we will bless them. Anyone else? Pardon me? Okay, a term. Okay, her Guyanese sister is making sure that we understand that is a Guyanese saying, offer up. Okay, thanks for the clarification. All right, this morning, any other person want to share anything before we move on? And anything you might have to share, you might think it's insignificant, but you'll be surprised that what you say might assist some person either online or here at church who had a particular problem during the week, and what you say might be the answer or the antidote to that position that they're going through. This morning, before we go into our study, let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you that for giving us the opportunity, as my brother said, to be alive and to be at church today. We invite the presence of the Holy Spirit in our midst to bring back to our minds what we would have studied so we can make a meaningful contribution to the study this morning. At the end of the exercise, may each of us be drawn closer to you. This is our prayer, for Christ's sake. Amen. Planning for success. Planning for success. When you heard that topic, what did it say to you? What did it say to you in terms of success? Does it say to you success comes just like that? Or in order for success to come, there has to be some planning? Now, so the lesson this week looks at some of the ways in which individuals can plan for success. Now, before I get into the lesson study per se in terms of the memory tech, there's a comparison made, asked for in Sabbath afternoon. They're looking at the lives of two persons, two well-known persons. Joseph, you know, who went into Egypt as a slave, worked his way through Potiphar, ended up in prison, but moved from the prison to the palace in a day. Now, that seems to be a story of success. Then there was John the Baptist. He was the forerunner for Christ. But how did he end up? He ended up being beheaded in a prison by a woman who had nefarious activities in her mind. Now, the question is asked, were both of them successful? Or was Joseph successful and not John the Baptist? Or was John the Baptist successful and not Joseph? I want your comments. Who'll be first? Okay, give her the mic, please.
Good morning, everyone. I would say that both of them were successful in their own rights because they have followed the course that God had planned for them, and they both came to an expected end. John the Baptist, he was beheaded, so he was martyred. And many Christians after him became martyrs for the word, for Christ.
Amen, amen.
And once you live the life that God expects you to live, I think that is the most important thing. What you do with that life that he gives you, if you are an example, even if you shall lose your life, God says that in his word, you shall gain life again, if you shall lose it for him. So it depends on how you live it, if you're living for yourself or if you're living for Jesus Christ at the end of the day.
Okay, thank you, sister. Anyone else want to give their comments? Joseph and John the Baptist, do you have a view different to our sister, or do you believe Joseph was successful and John wasn't, or John was successful and Joseph wasn't? Any views? Please take the mic. Yes.
Thank you. I look at it as for us Christians, okay, Joseph had a difficult start because of what his family did with him. Mm-hmm. And then even though that he went down to Egypt and he was living the life that God asked him to live, he was still treated unkindly by Potiphar's wife. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like, for us, if we look at it in these times, sometimes it can left a difficult or a challenge for us, knowing that we are serving God and we are still going through these hardships. But he continued in his relationship with God, and God brought him out in a much better place, that he was able to help his family. And I like what he said when he said that, you know, told his brothers, you intended for bad,
evil, yes,
but God intended for good.
Yes.
So, you know, sometimes we have to look at that. And just last night, when I was doing my devotion, I realized that, I'm going to come back to John.
Go ahead.
I realized that there are things within us, and we want to get to heaven. We want to have that relationship with God, that he will save us, and we will spend the ceaseless ages of eternity with him. But there are things within us, the roughness on us, and those things that are not fit for God's kingdom. So he's going to work with us and bring out those and try to get rid of those spots that will hinder us from having that beautiful relationship with him. And I think that is something that came true for me with Joseph. There were things that God wanted to work with him to show him who he is and what he wants to do in his life.
Amen.
That he can have that wonderful relationship with his brothers when he meet them up again, and also with the children of Egypt, because they were also difficult and they did not like the Jews. Now we come to
John.
John was, you know, like he was the forerunner for Jesus, But I don't think that he understood that when Jesus came on the scene, he would have had to go off. Is you know, like I sometimes think he's a little unfortunate, but his life also is a testament for us today that whatever situation we find ourselves in, God is still with us, and he is still going to bring us out in a successful place, or a place where we are going to be a representative of him and do the best that he wants us to do.
Yes. One thing you said there, though, I just want to clarify. When John saw Jesus, he said, I must decrease so that he must increase. He said, I'm not even worthy to lace his shoe. So John understood his position as far as Christ was concerned. Where John's situation was, John, like most Jews, had the understanding that Jesus was going to set up an earthly kingdom. So when his disciples came to him, he said, go and ask Jesus if he's the Messiah. And what did Jesus say? Go back and tell John what you saw. You saw the blind made to see, the deaf could hear, the dumb could speak, etc. So when John got that information, then he realized that Jesus indeed was the Messiah. Now, success depends on through whose eyes you're looking based on this lesson study, whose lenses you're looking. Now, if you're looking through the lens of the world, Joseph would have to be seen the one successful. He became the second most powerful man in the most powerful nation on the earth at the time. He was vice president, so to speak, of Egypt. John died in a prison, but Jesus Christ said, for what shall it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose? So when you look through the eyes now of Christ, of God, you recognize the successful person that God is really looking for is that individual who has that relationship with him. And as the sister said, maintain it. Now, when you come to Christ, the Bible says, all who will live godly must suffer persecution. So when these difficult things come into our lives, they are there because God has permitted them for the understanding that he's working with us. And sometimes there's something about the human being. We don't seem to learn lessons unless they're painful. Go back to your mind and see. The times that you've learned most is when you had a painful experience, not on the mountaintop. So God takes us down in the valley, allows us to have those temptations, those difficulties, so that he can have those erroneous things removed from our characters so we can be ready for him. So I agree with you, sister. Anyone want to say anything else?
I just wanted to say, you know, when I look at the life of Joseph mm-hmm. and the life of
John the Baptist, yes.
And as a lady, my friend here, my sister here was saying just now, and also Sister Rocha, I am reminded of that passage of scripture. Though he slay me.
Yes, that's Job.
Yet will I
trust
live
him.
Again. And mm-hmm. yes, yet will I trust him. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not an easy task, you know, Joseph and John. You know, it's not an easy task to go ahead and say, all right, I'm serving God, and then I'm faced with all of these temptations, I'm faced with all these trials and persecutions. But I'm also always reminded, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And yes. That really went through my mind just now. Maybe we're speaking of those two gentlemen. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you for your comments. Let's take a look at our memory text. It says, it's taken from Colossians 3, 23 and 24. And this is the New King James Version. It says thus, and whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you served the Lord Christ. The Colossians. Now, this was written by the Apostle Paul. And Paul was writing this to Christians who were in slavery. They were in slavery. And here is Paul is saying to them, and whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. In other words, you are a child of God. Act that way even though you might be in slavery. He continues, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. There is something you will be rewarded if you remain conscientious and true to God. And it says, for you serve the Lord Christ. Now this is a message to us. The Bible says, whatever you find your hand, whatever you put your hand to do, do it heartily. No one having put his hand to the plow and turning back, said Jesus, is fit for my kingdom. So we're going to meet obstacles. We're going to meet difficulties. But as your sister said, though you slay me, yet will I trust you. That was the mindset that Job had. The three Hebrew boys, when they were about to be thrown into the fiery furnace, the God that we serve is able to deliver. But even if, we still ain't bowing down. So we have to be, but you see, you can only make that decision when you trust in God. Yes, fully, okay. When you trust in God. So that relationship, that connection with Christ must be in place. So that when difficulties come, and not they might come, they will come, you are prepared to deal with them. Anybody want to make any comment on the memory text? Yes. Thanks.
All right, so good morning. So basically you're saying that in this life,
mm-hmm.
to be able to develop the character that the Lord wants you to have, mm-hmm. you gotta go through the crucible.
Correct.
You gotta go through like the fires of affliction.
There you go.
To be molded.
Mm-hmm.
To get to that stage where your faith has been tested and tried, and you reach the other side.
Yeah, you're correct. Yeah, I but you put it more beautiful than I ever put it. But yes, it is a part of your Christian walk that persecution will come because you have left Satan's kingdom, and when you have left Satan's kingdom, he will come after you. And guess what, class? God allows him. God allows him. So that when Satan doesn't only accuse God about Job, he accuses God about you too. And you too. Look, this sister is only following you. This brother is only following you because you do A, B, C, D. Remove A, remove B, remove C. And what, so Job part one is now Job part two in Israel lives. You want to make a comment? Yes, go ahead.
Before I didn't give my life to Christ, right? Everything was going fine. No sickness. Nothing so. But you see, since I gave my life to Christ, every day is something. First thing that had me was diabetes, hypertension, anxiety, all sort of things, one after the other, and they're just coming at me. And a family of three, I am the only person in that family always see. And sometimes I see myself as Job. I see myself as Job, and you know, it gets to me now that no matter what kind of sickness come at me, it God help me that I could be so, get so strong. That I don't even worry about if I get sick today or anything.
I just want to ask you a question. Have you ever thought that you are the only person in the family that could bear that? God doesn't put upon us any more he can bear. Maybe that on the other members of the family might bring them down. But you have a resolve within you that God said, yes, you can test my child with this. Because the spirit of prophecy says nothing comes to the child of God without first passing through this hand. And God is interested in all aspects of our lives. So I just ask you, you can take it from the other perspective, that you are probably the only member in the family who's capable of handling that. So God allow you to come to it.
At the end of every sickness, mm-hmm. you always see me through.
Okay.
Even though I go through so much pain, at the end
you still have a testimony.
Successful, and I always have a testimony.
Okay.
Always. Even on the last communion, mm-hmm. that morning, I was to go to work, and I did not get to go to work. I had to bake the communion bread.
Mm-hmm.
And it so happened. But still, I had to go to work for 12 o'clock, and I was like, I don't know why this bread taking so long for me. All the time this bread take, like, finish fast, and never know that accident was waiting there for me. And it came out that my husband didn't get any hurt. My daughter didn't get, like, the condition, but I get hit on my penis and my shoulder. I was in worst pain ever. And I said, Lord, here it comes. God, thanks and praise that every time something happened to me,
well, you're following the Apostle Paul. Paul said, in some things, give thanks. No, in all things, we should give thanks. Now, when we got to Sunday's study, the lesson admonished us as to the best time that we should give our lives to Christ, our lives to God. When is that time? Pardon me? When the question is, at what time in your life? In what time of your life? Yeah. In your youth? Yeah. Yes. Remember the Creator in the days of the youth. Why do you think Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, is saying that in your youthful days, that is the time to come to God?
I think we are supposed to give ourselves in our youth because we are the most energetic at that time.
Okay.
You have the most I can't say abilities, but God blesses you and strengthens you in areas that
useful exuberance.
You may not be strengthened when you get older. Yeah?
Okay.
In the youthful days, too, the mind, you could curve the mind in the youthful days.
Mm-hmm.
The mindset, like a tree, you plant a tree. It grows, you nourish the tree from small, mm-hmm. and it grows to how you like this. So God nourished the brains. I say when you get old, you don't nourish the brains, but you get to carve the mind more when you're small. So when you get old now, the thing that imparted in the tree or imparted in the child, it won't depart, they might slip or whatever, but it won't depart from them. It will register, if you understand.
Right.
When you were young, you know, you're more vibrant, I think. When I was a little younger, I gave my heart to God when I was very young. I could have been I was raised in a Christian home. Yes, but I gave my heart, you know, got baptized and everything. It wasn't Adventist church then, but I got, I could have been like 12 years old or so. And I was so on fire. I was so interested in the things of God. And at that age, your mind is so ready. I mean, you give your heart to God, you want to give everything, you want to do everything and do everything His way.
Right.
All right? And you want to read your Bible more, you want to pray, you want to sing, you want to do so many things at that age. And then you're coming up in your teenage age, oh my goodness, you are on fire, especially when you give your life to God at a young age, you know, and you make that decision in your life, God, I will serve you until the end. You know, so that's the reason why I think you're planning for success, because you're planning for success here. You're planning for success, and you ask God to help you in everything and whatnot. You know, you're so vibrant at that age. And you're able then to look forward and look for the future when you give your life to Christ at a young age. Yeah.
All right. Next in our study, we
Elder, I just want to make one more
okay,
point.
Go ahead.
When you get, as it grow older too, you get more stubborn. And they think that all of us could testify to being more stubborn as you age.
Stubborn off setting your ways.
Yes. And you get set in your ways, and it's so hard to change.
For those of you who are in agriculture, you know, at what stage is it best to bend a plant? When it's young. So that's the point that's coming through here. Yes. So we're moving on with our lesson. We're looking here at Jacob. Now Jacob is a very serious study, interesting study from the Bible. Jacob and his mother decided that they're going to deceive his father and his brother. Now Jacob, having done that, he's fleeing from home because his mother told him, you better run because your brother, who is a hunter, is going to come after your life. He made a mistake. He made a mistake. He was wrong. He tried to help God. And in the Bible, every time people try to help God, they end up in trouble. You realize that? He tried to help God because God has said to his mother that she has two children in her, and the younger one is the one to get the birthright. That is what God had said. Had they left it, God would have worked it out. But when she overheard Isaac telling Esau to go and get the venison, come back and prepare it, and then he would bless them, she felt that God needed help. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I get myself in that situation. I like to fix things. Waiting on the Lord is not something that I am very adept at doing. But I'm learning to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. It's not an easy thing for a man, especially as a family, to see things happening, to decide you want to take things in your hand. It is innate within us. However, he goes off. He made a mistake. He goes to sleep in the wilderness. He takes a pillow, or a stone for his pillow. Who meets him there? God meets him. So he made a mistake. Don't get my point. He made a mistake, but God did not give up upon him. Anybody in this class ever made a mistake yet? So you see the point where I'm going with this. Satan will tell you, no, you made that mistake. God wants no part of your life. That's not true. Adam and Eve made a mistake. Did God come after them? Paul was on his way to Damascus to do damage. Did God come after him? So God is in the business of coming after us, even if we make mistakes. Now, he makes plans. He said, the Lord, all that I get, I'm going to give you back a tenth. What the lesson is trying to share here is that having made his spiritual and financial plan, then God leads him to a wife. Amen? You get the point? When you are in a position to provide for a wife, that is when to start thinking about one. So you don't get married and then look for a job. Huh?
As a man, you should be in a position that when you take on a family, you're in a position to run the family. If your wife, and this is biblical, if your wife can assist you, that's fine. But the responsibility of the family falls on the man. You know, in Israel, the husband, the male, was the one responsible for the family. The woman, as far as the Bible is concerned, she the rearing of the children. But now, because of the way things are in this world, sometimes one salary isn't enough to make it. So unfortunately, the housemaker has to work. But that was not God's ideal plan. He told Adam what? By the sweat of your brow, you shall eat bread. He said to Eve, in sorrow, you will bring forward children. So that mandate came from God. But circumstances have switched it somewhat. But Jacob, what the lesson is bringing out here is that Jacob made financial and spiritual decisions before God led him to Leah. In fact, to Rachel. If you look at the study here on the Sunday study, it says this. After Jacob made his spiritual and financial commitment to God, the Lord directed him to Rachel at the well. It is fitting to make your spiritual decision and your life decision before committing to marriage. Now, that is to males, but I suspect it is to everybody, because most of you women, I am sure, if you are already married or you want to get into marriage, you see yourself wanting to make a contribution to your family. I saw a hand. Yeah. Okay. We have the guy speak first, and then we pass the mic around.
Yeah, I was going to say that that seemed to be a trend from Abraham and Sarah, trying to help the Lord.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Then Rebecca tried to help the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And then even when Leah and Rachel had, they still tried to, mm-hmm. to see who can get the most children, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So it seemed to be like a trend that people in general,
right.
This, as you said earlier, this tend to want to say if I could give the Lord a hand, mm-hmm. because the Lord ain't really know what's going on down here.
He's taking a little
too long. He ain't know what's going on in Barbados. He ain't know what's going on in the world. Right. So. We got to give you a little push, and then you know, we still down here.
In fact, we come up with a saying, the Lord helps those who help themselves. And that's not true. And some people quote it as though it's in the Bible, you know. I've heard our prime minister quoting it already. The Lord helps those who help themselves. The Lord helps those who are helpless. Look, the Lord helps those who are helpless. Okay, next comment. Pastor Mike, you want to say something on the topic? Go ahead. Speak into the mic.
More so, yes, it's a human thing for one to want the things to do their own thing at times. One of the most obvious, when a person can able to put their confidence, they're all in God. Because if you look at Jacob didn't make a mistake, but it was all the Lord's plan. Right? The Lord had, from the beginning, that is what he said in his word. That is what I think it was Jeremiah 1. He said that I choose you from in the beginning, from since in your mother womb. I chose thee. Right? And the thing is, God looked directly within a person. He knows the mindset of that person. And that is why Jacob would have been chosen by God to become the heir. To bring forth that generation, that godly generation, which would have given ear to God's teaching, His commandment. And today is the same thing we has here with us, is that those that are called by God, that are being chosen by God, not as how man may see it, but as how God see it. There are many of us who would have yes want to do our own thing, but those that are being guided by God are the real true ear of God.
Okay, it's just that even those who are guided by God made mistakes, because we are living in a sinful world and we are sinful people. And if it's one thing you know about sinners, is that what? They will sin. Okay, sis.
Yeah, the point I'm trying to make, although we are sinners and we make mistakes and God come after us, deception is something we have to be aware of. Just like how Adam and Eve was deceived from inception. Look and see the consequences after that. They was born into wealth to, replenish the earth, what's not. They had to work. But after sin now,
right? We have to be sweating and, I mean, doing all sort of...
You mentioned something there that brings us to the next point. Let you finish your point and then I'll comment.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
It's okay.
She said that they didn't have to work. Is that really true? When some measure, they had to work. Work was ordained by God. It is as though God, in making the human being, recognize the importance of work. What I can say about it, they had to work harder after sin. You had to work harder. Yeah. They had to work harder. Because thorns and thistles and the earth now became less replenishful in the way that it yielded up the fruit, etc. And that's productive. Thanks for that word. So God, in creating the human being, recognized the importance of work for his development.
Yeah, right.
You know? So it's from God. Yeah. It is from God. Thank you. Kevin wanted to say something. Pass the mic, please. And then we move on to the next point.
In the beginning, when God would have created, before he created man, he made the garden. And he is the one that made work. So when he would have created the garden, he had plants and trees and all these things with him. And when he created the man, he put him there and he said, what? He tell him to dress the garden and so on. You understand? And we see clearly that God would have made work. If God would not have made work for man, what it is it that man would have been doing? Just sitting down doing nothing? Sitting doing nothing? Remember, even to our organs and every part of our body has to be operating in some way or the other. So likewise, in a typical example, we know for sure that is the reason why God would have prepared work, because man is a living soul. He bring men to become a living soul on earth. So every other thing is about movements.
Okay,
about
thank
doing
you.
Things.
All right. The second paragraph on the Monday study, it says, the work was not a punishment, obviously. It was designed for their good, that even in paradise, even in a world in which no sin, no death, and no suffering existed, God knew that human beings needed to work. He must have labor to call into exercise the wonderful organs of the body. So if your body isn't exercised, there's something called atrophy, which kicks in and you become lazy and fat and you become despondent. So the human being is a machine. All machines become more efficient with use. So if you don't work, then your body is going to go into atrophy, as I said. No sooner, it says here, had he, God, created them, that he gave them his appointed work. So work was appointed by God who made them. So it's like God being the creator, he knows what is best for us, and he designated work as so. Now we come to the earning years. These are the years that you think as a family, that you plan, you look to put things in place. And if these earning years, in fact, let me put it this way, in families where the earning years doesn't lead to success, it brings problems into the marriage. In fact, when they look at there are four things that they mention that brings about divorce, money is number one. Money is number one. Lack of communication, lack of trust, children and in-laws, in that order. So that's the order. But money is right up there. In fact, money is mentioned in the Bible so many times in so many different ways. So how you, if it is such an important part of our lives, we need to plan how we're going to deal with it. Because if you don't plan, chances are you're going to find yourself in difficulty. So you have to work with integrity. Now, that word integrity is a word that speaks about somebody who's sound, somebody who's trustworthy, somebody who's diligent. You know, so if you're working diligently towards a particular cause, towards your family, or if you are single, maybe you're helping some other family, you know, but it is always, your reason for working has a lot to do with how you're going to approach work. You agree with that? Your reason for working has a lot to do with your mental approach to it.
If you say it as a task, if you say it's difficult, every day you go work, you're going to complain. You're going to complain. Exactly. If you say it as an opportunity now God has given you to contribute to your family, to help those who are less fortunate, you approach it completely differently. So working with integrity. Anybody want to make any comment on this before we move on to Thursday's study? All right. Yeah, go ahead.
I see work as when you're, okay, you said that if you go to work and thinking about how difficult it is, it's going to get more difficult.
Yeah.
But when I see work as, for me, I see work as it is who I am. And if I'm a Christian, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to act like a Christian. It's going to be important to me because it is going to be showing that I represent God. Everything that I do is representing God. And I think that work is showing that I am thankful for what God has given me. And I want to do the best that He wants me to do. Mm-hmm.
All right, any other comments on integrity and work? So we have established that work was given to mankind from the beginning. We've established that working is important. We've established that one's mindset towards work has a lot to do with how one is going to go about it. When we came here with work and integrity, 10 minutes? Yeah, thanks. Yeah. When we are working with integrity, it is that we are now guided by God's law. That if you're in a relationship with Him. So God's law works from the point of view that it has principles. And those principles are lifelong. And the thing about principles do not change. Thou shall not steal is a principle. You don't steal when your children are hungry. You don't steal because the opportunity comes. It is a principle. You don't steal under any circumstance. So God's laws are principles. Now, we've come to understand that both honor and riches come from God. Tell me some persons in the Bible that you know that were wealthy, filthy rich, so to speak, and had a relationship with God. Okay, I hear Job, Solomon, David, Abraham, Moses. Well, Moses, okay. Job, we had Job, Joseph. How about the New Testament? That came to God. Zacchaeus accepted Christ, and he was rich, and he contributed. But the guy who came to God at night, Nicodemus, he was a rich person. He was a rich, and his partner Joseph of Arimathea, the one in who provided the tomb in which Jesus Christ was buried. They were rich men. Now, so it's no sin to be rich. And sometimes we Christians tend to give people the idea that if you're rich, something's wrong. Jesus warned against the love of riches, not riches. Because if unfortunately, it seems to appear that most rich people seem to put their riches before God. So Jesus Christ addressed that about being rich. But there's nothing wrong in being rich. E.G. White, in her writings, however, makes it clear that there are some of us that God is going to keep riches away from us because in His wisdom, He knows if I bless Blamer with riches, He can go on and left me. And I care more about his soul in heaven than for him to be rich on earth. That person that he got, if I bless he with riches, but I love he too much. I love he too much to make you rich, man. So I could keep him poor, complain. so you got love me. Well, poor from that perspective, he will still provide all my needs. But I ain't like you. You see that mentality that you got there. Ever make you rich, you're gone. Now, not only he needs me. I died for him, and I know what is best for him. So I keep he humble. Now you're smiling, but maybe that might be in some of your lives as well. Can I have the mic, please? Let her comment and then you. Okay, go ahead. Keep your point.
Uh-huh. In Adventism, right? That is where it talks about training up a child from the home. Mm-hmm. That as from the tender age, when you teach a child, train them to observe the things them that God requires for them in their lives, especially when coming to work and all these things. Mm-hmm. When you educate them about those kind of stuff, and they would have the knowledge that they have to work to earn to make a living directly,
mm-hmm.
right? And as they grow up and they get older, they will understand that the world out there is vaster and bigger than them. And once they're being prepared from the home, whether biblically, you just name it, so that when they go out there, they would have understand how to manage themselves.
Okay, I get where you're coming from, Kevin. Kevin is saying that when you prepare your children for the workplace, for the world, that preparation has to begin at home. So when you give your child a task to do, make sure he or she completes it. Make sure to do it diligently. And as parents, you got to keep after them, because children seek the path of least resistance. And that's where both parents got to come together, because they will play mommy against daddy or daddy against mommy. So you got to make sure, in my case, if Toby comes and she asks me a question, I will usually ask her, did you ask your mother?
Yeah.
So what did your mother say? So if your mother said no, but I said it's no for me too. But they will play. So now she understands that she needs to make sure she checks with both of us. So the whole idea that Kevin is trying to make that I'm commenting on is that preparation for the world begins in your home. And children learn by precept and by example. You cannot tell them to do one thing and you do something else. I said it here Wednesday night and I say it again. There's no one who can spot a hypocrite quicker than a child. I taught for 41 years and I can tell you that. You cannot fool children. A child can look at you based on how you get and determine whether you are genuine or not. Sis.
You had mentioned about where God knows, you know, the position to put you in, and so that, you know, like if you get rich, that you would walk away from him.
Mm.
But, and you also mentioned poor, but I want to say that, you know, none of us who are Christians are poor, because we have a Father who is rich in houses and lands.
Agreed.
Who will lift the wealth of the world in his hands. And he is always taking care of us. We may not have the things that we want, but God is constantly
give us everything that we need.
Giving us the things that we need.
Yes.
And even more, because he gives us a little bit more to help others as well. So we are not poor. It's just that we see the ways of the world and the people with money who are not Christ-like, and we want to have that opportunity where we have enough that we can, you know, spend as we like.
I agree with
you,
sister.
We consider ourselves poor, but we are not poor.
Right. That word poor was used only in the context of how the world sees rich or poor. But you've articulated well. My Father is rich in houses and land. So if I am a child of the King and I'm heir to his throne, then I'm not poor. I may not have what the world sees as riches, but I'm rich in Christ, and God said I supply all your needs according to his riches in glory. Yes. But share quickly, because we only got about four more minutes.
I was told by my ex-boss that I am poor.
Mm-hmm.
So I told her that I am rich in the Lord. I don't have to be, if you see me poor, I know that I'm rich in the Lord. I don't have to be rich at birth, but maybe if I'm not rich at birth, maybe my riches in heaven.
Well, you're,
so when I told her that, that is so true. I said, whatever God bless me, I am happy.
Yes. In closing, the lesson mentions here seeking godly counsel. In everything that we do, we should seek to have God guiding. For instance, get organized, develop a spending plan, spend less than you earn. Save a portion for every pay period. Go to the aunt, thou sluggard, consider his ways and be wise. Avoid debt like COVID-19. You know, stay away from it as much as possible. Be a diligent worker.
Yeah.
When you go to your workplace, as I mentioned earlier in the lesson, do all that you do to bring honor and glory to God. When you walk out of there, that individual, if he or she is not a Christian, can say one thing about this worker, he or she can be trusted. And be financially faithful with God. That is speaking in about your stewardship, returning of your tithe, returning of your offering. You know, there's no out for that. You give back to God the tenth and then he blesses you accordingly. And last and by no means least, remember that this earth is not our real home. The song says, this world is not my home. I'm just doing what?
Through.
My treasures are laid out there, somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. So as the lesson last week pointed out to us, we got to store up our treasure in heaven. We got to have that relationship with God so that when we meet with God in heaven, we will have an inheritance there. So I will advise you to continue to study so that we can participate in the lesson next week. Go ahead, Kevin.
Yes, can I read Isaiah 1:19 to you? I think we are off. It says, if you be willing and obedient, he shall eat what is the good of the land.
Good morning, everyone. Well, good morning again, everyone. Our lesson study has now come to a close. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you learned something new. Teachers, Sabbath school has come to an end. Let's all wrap up quickly so that we can close Sabbath school. Good morning. Is everybody settled? As we wrap up lesson study and we close our Sabbath school, I'd just like to say I hope it was a true privilege and that we all enjoyed our Sabbath school session this morning. 1 John chapter 4, verse 9 and 10 says, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." The Bible clearly tells us of Jesus' love for both us and for his world. And if there's one thing we should never doubt, is that God's love truly is faithful.
Faithful.
Sabbath school now stands adjourned until next Sabbath.
There's a gentleman called Mr. LaRue. Now, LaRue was an Adventist early in the infancy of the church. He became an Adventist when he was given some literature, and he read it, and he was convinced about the Sabbath. And so he gave his life to Christ. But he had a yearning, and that desire was to be a missionary to China. He wrote General Conference, and he asked them to provide him with funds to go to China. But there were two things that were against him as far as General Conference was concerned. His age. He was in his late 60s. They said to him, you are too old, and we don't have the finances by which we can send you to China. But he wrote them again. And again, they said the same thing. So having written them a couple of times, they decided, well, look, why don't you go to one of the South Pacific Islands? He did so, and he went to Hawaii. While he was in Hawaii, he decided, wait, if I'm in Hawaii, I can get to Hong Kong. And so he got to Hong Kong. What he was doing while he was there, he was a literature evangelist. He was selling books. But when he got to Hong Kong, he had the book Steps to Christ translated from English into Chinese, and he went over to China. To make a long story short, he was told they had no money, and he was told that he's too old. That did not stop him. As a result of that, there are between 400,000 to 500,000 Chinese Seventh-day Adventists. That was because LaRue did not turn back when he was disappointed. Now, why am I telling you this? We are going into the field. I'm not asking you to go to China. I'm not asking you to go to Japan. I'm asking you to go to Harlington. Where is Harlington? Harlington is that area when you exit here and you go to your left, the first right turn, all of those houses on your right as you go around by the playing field, etc., that is Harlington. That is where we are going in preparation for the campaign by Pastor Morgan. Now, Pastor Thorne took meticulous pains to divide us into units. So each unit will have a specific area in Harlington to work. Your leaders, your class teachers, your discussion leaders will be given the particular road or gap that they're working, and you will follow them in this. Now, we are planning to go into Harlington. In fact, let me tell you this. Brother Tony and Brother Peter have been going into Harlington for about a month, and that is the reason why we are going, because they have set the ground for us. I had the opportunity to go with them on Wednesday. And I can tell you, as I said on Wednesday night, that the harvest is ripe. In fact, as I speak to you now, there are individuals in here today from Harlington who are not Seventh-day Adventists, but wants to become our members. Amen? So there are people worshiping with us today from Harlington. In fact, Brother Tony just went to collect another lady who the water was off, so she couldn't come early, but he's gone to get her. So the harvest is ripe. The laborers are few. When your teachers ask you, please respond positively. Now, you're going to be given those dates a little later as to when we'll be going into the field. Now, part of the work that we're doing in preparation for the Morgan's campaign is that we'll be going through a lesson study, a Bible study, so to speak. There are six lessons in this study, and we want you to take these six lessons one at a time. So there are six times that we'll be deliberately going to Harlington. So you can't put your hand to the plow and turn back. Because when your particular class has a particular area to work, no other persons will go there. Now, we're sending you out in two by twos. That's that we're following the model of Jesus Christ. Jesus sent the disciples out two by two. And there's a reason for this. The reason for that is that the weaker one can help the stronger one. Or if for some purpose one of you can't make it a week, that particular family whom you have registered will still get the lesson. So we want to have continuity. So please keep in tune so that when your teachers speak to you, that you will be ready. We can give you ample notice as to when we're going to be doing this so all of us can be prepared. Now, can you see the hands of all those who would like to be part of history? To be part of history. Okay. People like to be part of history because it causes them to be able to have bragging rights. Let me tell you what I mean by that. Now, when I was still at school, I went to Kensington Oval when Lawrence Roe made 302. Any cricket enthusiasts in here? 302, right. I was there. Now, when I tell this story, you'll get the impression that I saw the entire innings. Well, if you know the story, well, Lawrence Roe made the bulk of his runs on the Saturday, which was the Sabbath. I had to be at church. But when I tell the story, I tell the story as though I was there because I was there the Friday evening. Are you with me? I saw the first part of the innings, and those persons who saw that innings say that the 54 that he made the Friday evening was the better part of the innings. But when I tell the story, I tell the story as though I was there for the entire innings. So you don't do that. Now, why am I telling you this? History is going to be created this evening. What am I speaking about? Good News will be having its first singing band. And we are amalgamating with my former church, Amazing Grace. Now, I want you to be part of history. So I want you to plan to be there. Now, we are going to be in the city. Why the city? Because AgriFest begins today. And we are going, the field is ripe. We are going where the field is ripe. We want to share a message with the people there. We have presented the program, A Glimpse of the Christ, which will be the open-air service. And then we move smoothly into the singing band. So if you want to go to the city and you don't have transportation, I am asking all those members at the church who are going that have transportation to make yourselves available. Now, the program begins at 4 p.m. So you can't leave here at 4. So we're leaving here around 3 o'clock so we can get to the city, so we can meet those persons going in and out of AgriFest, so we can give a message to them, so also whatever funds they have that they can give towards in gathering, we'll be able to do so. Is that a good plan? Do you want to be part of history? So am I going to see you in the city this afternoon? All right, I ain't getting much response about yes. I want you to be like LaRue. No matter how old you are, come out. Let's go over to Macedonia and help them in gathering. Now, last week I told you we had $344. That's what we collected in our first week. Now, based on what I've seen and what the treasurer has given me, we are over $1,000. Somebody say amen. Yes, but all of you, all of us are not contributing. Don't be weary of well-doing. Go forward. God will bless you as you go forward. Remember what we have said before. When you gather, there are at least three blessings. You are blessed because you go. Amen? The persons who give are blessed because God loves a cheerful giver. And then the individual who is blessed by the solicitation, there are three blessings. So God wants to bless you. He wants to bless us. So please plan to take part in a Harlington experience. Looking for you in the city this evening as we inundate the city with the message of God. God bless you. Real good.
Good morning, church. I know there are too many of you in here for me to have that feeble-minded good morning. So let us do this again. We don't need to be doing this every Sabbath, so we'll do it one time. Good morning, church. Thank you so much. That sounds a lot better. Now, we have some visitors in our midst, and one of those visitors is Kim and Shanice Harris. Could you stand that the Good News people can see you, please? Welcome to Good News. We're so happy that you're here with us. Now, we also have two members. Could you stand up? We can see you, please. Welcome to Good News. We are also welcoming back two of our members who have been out for a while. And for those of you who don't know, Sister Miatha and Trina Hetty, can you stand, please? Thank you so much. Welcome back. We're so glad to have you back with us worshiping at Good News. Can you kindly listen to your announcements, please? And these are the local announcements. On March the 18th, the AY department is planning to go through our surroundings, communities, and share the gospel through acts of service. We believe it is important to look in uniformed when we go out as a church. Therefore, the AY department is presenting you with the choice to purchase a drift polo shirt to be worn on this occasion and any other occasion in the future. Each shirt costs a total of $40 and range from size small to 3XL. The shirts are unisex and they come in the color black. Now, tomorrow is the deadline for payment to be made for these shirts. If you have ordered your shirts online, remember that the payment is due tomorrow. For those of you who cannot access the internet and can't get online, you can see Sister Rolene Thomas, who will guide you and help you along in that process. VMIX training is scheduled for March 5th at 3:30 p.m. for all interested persons. All members of the women's ministry are asked to meet directly after divine service. All members of women's ministry are asked to meet directly after divine service. Please remember that half an hour of prayer daily is from 12:30 until 1. Also, please remember to write all your prayer requests and place them in the prayer house at the front. Easy worship training is on March 19th at 3:30 p.m., and that will be here at Good News. Adventure Club resumes today at 3 p.m., and Bible study today at 2 p.m.
A pleasant Sabbath and good morning to everybody. We are here to promote two very important programs from ECC. Next Sabbath, the men's ministry department, which is also covered by the family life ministry department, will be hosting the men here. Now, what provisions have been made? The ladies of our church, Mount Sinai and the Six Roads Church, will be at Six Roads. I'll repeat that. The ladies of Good News, Mount Sinai and the Six Roads will be at Six Roads. The gentlemen from Good News, along with the gentlemen from Mount Sinai and Six Roads, will be here, and they will be in the company of all the gentlemen, the members, the male members of the church across the island. What are we supposed to do? We are supposed to come here as gentlemen. And of course, if some of the ladies don't have the transportation to get across the Six Roads, we take them across That's what brothers and sisters do. Family would operate that way. So that we will have the attendance. And I can tell you one thing, gentlemen. The program that is planned is going to be very informative for us as gentlemen. And by the way, this includes the boys and so. So you can bring them, let them stay here, they'll be well looked after. Our second promotion will come from Sister Celine, who is the Family Life Director.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. The Family Life Department from the Good News Church, in collaboration with the Family Life Director of the East Caribbean Conference, will be presenting a Family Life Week. It's starting on May the 8th. I'm sorry. March the 8th until the 11th. So we know that that's a Wednesday night, and we will have services in person. So we want to see everyone, because this in person at Good News from the Wednesday night of the 8th of March. And as I said before, in collaboration with Pastor Victor Marshall, who is the director for Family Ministries and Men's Ministries for the East Caribbean Conference. He will be the facilitator for the services. The Wednesday night, we'll be covering some very interesting topics. There's a flyer that is going around, and I hope that you're sharing it with your friends and your families. We're going to get some printed ones that can go there to give to our visitors as we go out in the field, so that they too can gain from this knowledge that is being presented to us. We'll be doing topics as such as living with threats from the enemy, on the run and responding to the threat, to the enemy's threats. Then the Sabbath morning, we're going to have the same format for the Sabbath school that we usually have. We're going to keep us in that vein. But in the divine hour, we'll be speaking on preparing for relationships restoration, and in the AY, a reposition for a journey of hope. So our theme for the week will be maintaining hope for families during adversity. So my task today is to invite each and every one of you to join us in person from Wednesday night the 8th. What day did they say? At 7 p.m., we're expecting to see each and everyone and to have these chairs filled. So thank you for your cooperation. Bring out your families, your little boys, your little girls, your husband, your wife, your sister, your brother, everyone, and come and join us for that period from the 8th to the 11th. May God continue to bless you and your families.
And by the way, thank you. By the way, our sister churches within the district will be joining us. Don't let them outdo us in relation to the number of members who are here. And we are partnering with the personal ministry department and all other departments of the church, because this is a precursor, really, for the upcoming campaign. And, of course, the prayer ministry will be there. God bless you as we work together and as we enjoy that session.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Sabbath, everyone. That's much better. Okay, so I am just giving a brief announcement on behalf of the health department. And we are looking at having a ballorama. And this will take place on April the 9th, which is Easter Sunday, right here at Oldbury. And we are going to be having quite a few ball associated games, so soccer being one of them, cricket, road tennis. Those three I know of for sure. And we want you to come out and support. We are going to be having teams from different parts of the community. So we're going to be mixing our teams, so we can be having persons from our community, and then we're going to be having persons in our membership playing together, exercising together, and fellowshipping with each other. So please, you will get more information as we get closer to the date, but I want you to bear this in mind. Put this as your remember to do thing in your calendars. The churches, we are going to be having our ballorama on April the 9th right here at Oldbury. So come out and give us your support.
Those were your announcements. Do continue to have a pleasant Sabbath.
Good morning, and a happy Sabbath. It is my honor to welcome each and every one of you today. You look lovely sitting down, but I would just like everyone to stand so that we can greet each other and get more familiar. We're going to sing this song, Why Don't You Greet Somebody in Jesus' Name. Why don't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Why don't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves again. Why don't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Why don't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Okay, I now see more smiles and joy and happiness. I hope that you enjoy the rest of your Sabbath as we minister to you guys, minister to you in many different ways. You can have a seat, have a good Sabbath.
Hi, good morning, church. Our scripture reading for this morning is taken from Isaiah chapter 28, verse 16. And it reads, therefore thus saith the Lord, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. There ends the scripture reading.
Wonderful Sabbath to everyone today. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Sabbath is a happy day. Happy day, isn't it? Sabbath is a happy day. I love every Sabbath. Not that we are going to sing that song, but we're going to do 435. 435 in the new. When all my labors and trials are o'er, and I'm safe on that beautiful shore, just to be near the dear Lord I adore, will through the ages be glory for me. Oh, that will be glory for me, glory for me. When by his grace I shall look on his face, that will be what? Glory for me.
And trials are o'er, and I am safe on that beautiful shore. Just to be near the dear Lord I adore, will through the ages be glory for me. Oh, that will be glory for me, glory for me, glory for me. Glory for me, when by his grace I shall look on his face.
223. 2, 2, 3. Crown him with many crowns. The Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the angel, how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own.
Every time in heaven and
do our hymn of continuation. 348. 348. The church has one foundation, which is what?
Jesus Christ, our Lord.
She is his new creation by water and the word. We are going to stand.
Okay, good morning once again, church. Can we turn our Bibles to Isaiah 28:16? And I would like the church to read this morning. Isaiah 28, verse 16. Okay, shall we begin? Amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church. We will now move smoothly into the intercessory prayer, but before we get into that, I want to remind all of our members and the visitors, if you have any prayer requests, just write it down on a small slip, and you could come and place it in this little structure here. These prayer requests are not read, they're not viewed. We just pray over them and ask the Holy Spirit to take control. So once again, any prayer requests, just come and place them right in here. All right? Let's bow our heads for a quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we have quite a few supplications we want to bring before your throne, but before we do any of that, we just want to ask that if there are any lingering sins among your people in this congregation, we want to ask, Lord God, that you remove them, cleanse our minds, our souls, of any iniquities, any transgressions, but not just cleanse us right now, but place within us a hatred and a disdain for sin, that we may not, like a dog to his vomit, return to these same bad habits, Lord God. So into your hands, I commit our bodies, our souls, our minds. Clean them and clear them for the presentation of your word, and open our hearts, Lord God, to receiving it, and not just receiving it, but applying it to our lives. Now, Lord God, I just want to ask and humbly beg that you watch over your daughter, Tobia Blenman, and her situation. You are the great healer. You're the great Rapha, and we want to ask, Lord God, that you touch her with your healing hand and its miraculous properties. Bring her whole again, that she could return to your sanctuary and serve you as she does so ably. So, Father, I just want to ask, Lord God, that any other individual who may be in similar situations as Tobia is right now, we ask that you also heal them, touch them, touch their families and comfort them, Lord God. We know that you're the great, not only the great physician, but the great comforter, the great provider. You're the great everything, Lord God. So we want to bring everything before you, ask that you take full control over it. We want to pray over the approaching in gathering, that it is a success, that your saints, your people come out to do your work. I want to ask that you provide the time. Make it appropriate, Lord God, for them to be able to come out with transportation. Whatever the hindrances, remove them and help them to be able to come out and do the work for the continuity of the gospel. I pray, Lord God, for the approaching crusade by your male servant, Pastor Morgan. I pray that you bring him here safely, give him the words to speak. And I pray that each and every individual that visits, each and every individual in the hearing of his voice is convicted and is encouraged to make a decision heavenward. We want to also pray, Lord God, for your speaker today, the pastor that is visiting our church. I want to ask that you bless him, Lord God, cleanse his mind, cleanse his tongue, cleanse his entire body, and allow the Holy Spirit to take control of him, Lord God, that he speaks to our visitors who may not necessarily be Adventists, but I pray, Lord God, that the word touches them and convicts them also. I pray, Lord God, over the entire program and whatever is left to be done, not just now, but at AY and those who are participating. I pray, Lord God, that you cover them, bless them, and help them to do so flawlessly. These things I ask in no other name but the name of our soon coming King, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let the church say, Amen.
Thank you. Good morning to everyone. We have our very own youth choir, GNC Youth Choir. And we are pleased to bring you a song today. We are a little disappointed because some of our members aren't here. We are praying for Tobia. We are praying for Shania. We are praying for Shanika because they were here with us on Thursday. But they are all ill, and we are saddened by that. But we pray that God would sing along with us, and that next time we are singing, they will be here with us, and that God's name will be uplifted and glorified. We are going to sing the song, "Once I was lost, I was deep in despair. Satan had me bound in my mind and everywhere. He has them bound, but Jesus brought me out, turned my life around, and now I'm on my way." So we pray that as we sing this song, we'll be sending Satan where he's to be, out, because we are in where God wants us to be.
Brought me out, turn my life around. Jesus brought me out,
Lovely singing. Amen. Our own GNC Youth Choir. You can expect more from them even today. All right. All right. It's time for the offertory. Let's bring the tithes and offerings into the storehouse. Numbers 18:28 says, "Thus ye also shall offer an heave offering unto the Lord of all your tithe, which ye receive of the children of Israel, and ye shall thereof the Lord's heave offering to Aaron the priest." Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for bringing us to the end of another week, where we were able to toil and labor and bring all our tithes and offerings unto you. Lord, bless those who have to give and those who don't have to give, Lord. Provide for them bountifully in the coming week, so they'll have to give next time. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Give thanks with a grateful heart.
Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now, let the weak say, "I am strong." Let the poor say, "I am rich." Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now, let the weak say, "I am strong."
God be praised. You've been having a blessed day in Jesus' name. The privilege is mine this morning to introduce the speaker for the hour. This young man presently serves as the ministerial secretary for the East Caribbean Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. So he's my boss. And it is good because Pastor Maurice Morancy has been a minister for over 20 years. He has served, however, during that time as the ranking officer, as island coordinator for the island of Dominica. So he has been the top man on Dominica for over 15 years, leading up the work there and helping the brethren in that part of the vineyard to experience the blessings of God. So we welcome him to Good News Community Church. And I believe his heart has already been blessed. Pastor Morancy is formerly married to the beloved Tricia Morancy, who passed away in recent time, but he's the proud father of two fantastic children. Darrell, and Denisa. Pastor Morancy loves the Word of God. He loves the people of God. And he is a servant of God. I therefore, with great joy, introduce to your pulpit the ministerial secretary of the East Caribbean Conference, Pastor Maurice Morancy. As Pastor Morancy comes, he's not only here to speak to you, but he has some work to do today. So right after the service today, he wants to meet with all the deacons and deaconess to have a little word in Jesus' name. But at this time, the pulpit is open to Pastor Maurice Morancy after the next item of music.
Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable to you, Lord. May the song that I sing, my life and offering, be pleasing, Lord, to you. And now I live to say,
acceptable to you.
May the song that I sing be pleasing, Lord, to you. All my heart pleasing, Lord, to you. Be pleasing, Lord.
Oh, let the words of my mouth, oh Lord,
be acceptable.
I want to be pleasing.
May the song that I sing
be
pleasing, Lord, to you.
Oh my
God,
I want to live pleasing, Lord.
We can say amen again and put your hands together for the youth choir. Well, I'm truly blessed by your beautiful singing. I said this is one gift that I covet, singing. I wish I could. It's a joy to be here this morning with you, to share God's time, to fellowship with wonderful people. And if you believe and think that you are wonderful, turn to the person next to you and say, I'm wonderful. Say thanks to your pastor, Pastor David Walks, for certainly the invitation to be here with you. Pastor, thank you so much. We have gone back a long way, I must tell you. When I was getting married, he was my counselor. So that tells you as to how far, you know, we've been, and certainly a friend to me and the family, a man of God who loves God's work, God's people, a thinker, organizer, and I believe that his ministry to you would be rewarding, and certainly as he's led by God to lead you, a great work that the Lord will do in him. Pastor, may the Lord continue to bless you richly and your family. I've known your elder, that's your first elder. That's quite a few years ago. Yeah, we were on assignment in Mexico. Powerful man of God. And I know the Lord is still working his thing in his life. And in the fullness of time, the Lord will come through. So may God bless you and your wife, and may he keep you all trusting. There are one or two persons I know here. Dupi, Sister Dupi, she's there? Okay, all right, we met this morning, I believe. And I know for sure Sister Victor, Kelly, Dominican. And if you have not been to Dominica, you need to please visit. It's one conference, right? And you should know the island, beautiful island. So it's a privilege to be here. I've been on island for, that's about a month. I'm living on somewhere around the 5th. I want to see this last program for this month come through, well, early March, that is. And that is to meet with all our elders across Barbados. We'll be meeting here. That's about 4 in the afternoon, Sabbath afternoon on the 4th March, all the elders across Barbados, as we put some things in perspective, as we train you, prepare you for the way forward, where we are going, not just as a conference, but as a union. So we look forward to all our elders. Please plan for it for next Sabbath. That's the fourth. Thank you so much. Your heads bow, your eyes close. Eternal God, we come. We come, Lord, seeking your direction. We come asking you to lead us. We are here, Father, to be filled with your presence, and may your word rest upon our hearts, and may, O God, the change that you want to see in us become a reality. May you bless this congregation, bless your people. And as we await your word, do for us, O God, a work that will transform our lives. I humble myself to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And amen. The foundation that is sure. The foundation that is sure. I must say to you that even before continue, I want to encourage you in terms of your evangelistic thrust, that you would work with someone, talk with your neighbors, talk with your friends, family members, as you prepare them for the upcoming program, Evangelistic Thrust, across Barbados, here, right here, on this site. I say this to you because I must. Also, the assistant to the president for evangelism. And we certainly want to height up this area, utilizing all the methods of evangelism. We need to do that as God's people. So we trust that as the island come together in this effort, that many, many, many souls will be won to the glory of God. Somebody say amen. 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 The foundation that is sure. In 2012, two surveys were conducted under the leadership of the General Conference Nurture and Retention Committee. The first survey dealt with members who no longer attended worship services or they left the church. The second survey dealt with members who had previously left the church for a period of time but began attending church again or returned to active membership. What was so amazing here about this survey is the point that it talked about three main reasons why people leave. One, the first one, top here, persons who pretend to be church members. They're not living the life. Top. So they left the church because of. Number two, marital conflict. And that I understand we have a big problem here. Not you, as good news, but maybe where I came from. You are okay. And the third, lack of friends in the church. We also discovered from the survey that 79% still believe in the authority of Scripture. 79%. Amen? And we trust we can target the 100%. 79. I want to say to you here that I love God's church. Do I have a witness? I love God's church. Now, the song might be too loud, so if you can drop, it would be great. Usually loud. So you could drop a little. Thanks. I love my church. From the day I came into church, I have been pretty active. I love my church. As a young boy at the age of 13, I remembered on several occasions before we would go to school to take that bus at 7:30. We would sit together, about four of us, you know, just in a quiet spot, and we would read the Word of God because we understood that the Word of God was powerful. I love my church. remembered that I was taken up by a member of the church. Maybe those days are gone. Taken up by a member of a church, and she made sure that every day, literally every day, that my meals were provided. And as a boy going to school, in the afternoon, I recall placing my bag down, take off my school clothes, and I would make my way up the road, and there I would enter that house and to see my food covered. I was privileged. God did it. Maybe those days are gone. Members are to fend for themselves. No care, no concern. But I remember that sunset, we would sit together and we would sing and we would praise God, and the whole community would know that it is Sabbath. But maybe those days are gone. Isaiah 28 and verse 16. Therefore, the Bible says, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation. Could you find the text, please? Isaiah 28 and verse 16. Or you can write it down. It's important. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious stone, a sure foundation. Somebody say amen. The practice of naming a city by the name of its leader was quite common in ancient times. In the book of Samuel, one would notice that Mount Zion was the site of the Jebusites. The Jebusites were a Canaanite tribe who lived in the city of Jebus, a descendant of Ham's son. The city of Jebus was located on a hill. On a what? And was surrounded by high walls. The Jebusites believed that their city was impregnable, and they were not afraid of the Israelites, the Jebusites. They were thought to be a warlike people and were known as a nation living in the mountains. The Jebusites were wicked people. They were what? Wicked people who worshiped false gods and engaged in human sacrifice. A worship that displeased God. Jebusites. My friends, the Israelites were instructed by God to drive the Jebusites out of the promised land and destroy the city. It was David who led his army, to capture the city of Jerusalem from the fiercely independent Canaanite tribe of Jebusites. He moved his capital to Jerusalem. Follow me here. And lived in the fortress of Zion. And there David built his palace, which he called the City of David. The City of David somehow was situated a few miles south of Jerusalem, called Mount Zion. Therefore, he saith the Lord God, behold,
I lay the foundation. I lay in Zion for a foundation. Zion is synonymous here with the city of God, and it's a place that God loves. Zion is Jerusalem. Zion signifies the high calling of God for his people. And God still has a high calling placed on us. Isn't that true? We are different, or we're supposed to be. We are precious. We are a people of royalty. Am I talking true? Zion signifies the high calling of God for his people. The standards were high, set by God himself. My friends, in prophecy, Zion represents the church. Zion represents what? The church. And Isaiah, through his vision, referred to the church, referred to the church that God loves. In Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 2, he says, I have likened the daughters of Zion as a comely and delicate woman. He loves the church. Am I talking to somebody? The word comely means good looking. The church is good looking. The church is dedicated. Delicate. A people dedicated to the glory of God. I'm told that a woman that is delicate is a virtuous woman. It's a what kind of woman? A virtuous woman. So in this world of religious confusion, I truly believe, like many of you here today, I believe that God has a church. Are we together? A church that is true. A church that is good looking. A church that is virtuous. Am I talking truth? God has a church. A church that is beautiful and clean. Pure. God has that church. It's in the word of God. We understand here that the church comes from the word ecclesia, meaning call out. We understand our responsibility. We understand that God has called us out. And if you fail to understand that, let me remind you that we are special. We are people of royalty. And therefore, when we walk, we got to walk with our heads lifted high. We must understand that we can't be a fearful people. We must understand who has called us and who we belong to. We must understand that. I understand here that my beauty, my purity is not dependent on the jacket I wear, but the righteousness of Christ living in me. I understand this. And we ought to, as a people. Well, let me push a little forward. God loves the church. God loves you. Tell the person next to you, God loves you. He loves the church. It's in Matthew 23 and verse 20 and 47. The Bible says here, O Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, how often I have longed to gather your children together. God is still in the business of gathering his children together. He loves you. He loves the church. Are we together? Follow me. Our scriptural passage points out that, behold, I lay in Zion a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious stone, a sure foundation. My friends, as I read the book of Isaiah, I must let you understand and know that Isaiah the book gives us accounts of Israel's sin. Yes. It talks about they being rebellious, a rebellious people. But it also gives good news. Are we together? Isaiah somehow, if you just run through the book of Isaiah, you will discover that Isaiah talks about a people responding to the voice of God. A matter of fact, the Bible says here, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and whom will go for us? And I said, here am I, send me. The book of Isaiah somehow talks about God's desire for his people. I can hear Isaiah saying, then I heard, oh, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. A sign. A virgin will be with child, and he will give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. God desires to be with you. God with man. Emmanuel. I can hear Isaiah saying, that's not all, but I want our people here at Good News to understand that God assures the church that peace will come. Hello, 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 peace will come. You didn't get this. For to us a child is born. And to us the son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Isaiah. Oh God, provided his church with hope. Or we all are like sheep who have gone astray. Let each of us, he says, rather each of us has turned to his own ways. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Oh, therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. My friends, a stone suggests stability. The church is built on Christ, the solid rock. And I believe with all that's happening now, we got to understand that the church is built on solid rock. Christ, a rock. But it's not just a stone. Isaiah wants us to understand here, that stone is tried. Are we together? That stone is tried. And if Jesus is tried, and if Jesus was tried, and we are on him, then expect the church to be tried. You gotta be tried. So why complain about your trials? Why complain about it? I've come to understand dealing with trials calls for an intimate relationship with God. And if you don't have that, then you are lost. You are lost. I came to understand that not too long this year, last year, but January, I came to understand that if we do not understand who God is, if we do not understand that God has the bigger picture in mind, then when the trial comes, we will not pass the test, but we will fail. I'm talking to somebody here. You may be going through your tried time, but understand that Isaiah talks about the tried stone, and Jesus himself was tried because he's talking about Christ, the precious stone. In other words, it's highly attractive. It's a value. But he didn't just say a precious stone. He said here a precious cornerstone. Somebody say amen. Rejected, yes. Let down, yes. Denied, yes. Oh, they call him Beelzebub. Tested and tried by the enemy. Died on Calvary. But on resurrection morning, Jesus rose again, declaring that he is the resurrection and the life. Somebody say amen. This stone, this precious cornerstone, has become the bedrock of Christianity. He's the foundation of my life, and my experience, and my relationship with my God. My friends, so let me move quickly here. My elder told me I have all the time in the world. Why? Because you are just good news. I took some time to check this out. So the site is there. And that site, I wanted to find out why the foundation is the most important part of a house. Listen to me. And these are the things that popped up. One, that the foundation supports the home. I say the foundation, Lord, supports the home. Every builder, do we have builders here this morning? If you're a builder, just raise your hand. None in good news. All right, we have two builders, three builders. God bless you. The foundation supports your home. And so it's important on which foundation the church is built on. It supports the home. I'm told that somehow the foundation depends on the foundation that you have. It resists movement. It resists movement. I found out that somehow it insulates your home. Especially in cold countries, the foundation, it keeps moisture out. Now, I can run a week of series here with this, where the foundation, it supports the church, it supports the home. The foundation resists movements, the shaking that is happening in the church now. I'm saying because the church is built on the sure foundation, we can deal with the movement. I'm talking to somebody. It insulates the home. It insulates what? The home. It somehow keeps the home warm. 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 I'm told here, quickly here, that the foundation prevents insects infiltration. Hello? Insects infiltration. Do we have them? The foundation. So my friends, I'm happy to tell you here from the hymn which says that the church has one foundation. Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is what? She is his new creation by what? By water and the blood. And from heaven he came and he sought her to be his holy bride. And with his own blood he bought her. And for life he died. As Seventh-day Adventists, we believe that the church is built on Christ. Or tell the person next to you, the church is built on Christ. It's built on Christ. It's not built on pastors. It's not built on men. Are we together? Jesus point this thing out when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi. He was asked by his disciples, or rather he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? You remember the story very, very, very well. They replied, some say, Jesus, that you are John the Baptist. Others say, Jesus, that you are Elijah. Some say that you are a prophet. But I don't want to hear what people say about me. I want to know what you say. Peter responded by saying, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And on the confession that Jesus is the Son of the living God, Jesus says, flesh and blood did reveal that to you. It's not because of your education or what you have learned. It's a result of the power of God. So we believe and know that the church is not built on Peter or the popes, but it built on Jesus Christ, the solid rock. Somebody say amen. The immovable rock, the enduring rock. That's on what the church of the living God is built. So my friends, permit me to tell you about that stone on which the church is built. It was the stone Daniel saw. Cut out of hand, smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and break them into pieces. That stone that filled the whole world. That stone. Isaiah says here, but he was pierced for our iniquities. He was chastised for our iniquities, pierced for transgression, and the punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds some child of God is healed. Oh, praise be to God. The power of Jesus. I tell you of the power of God, and God is able. I remembered on one of our visits in one of our territories, called to pray. Pastor, together with the elders, still a powerful team, went together and we prayed. And we prayed our hearts out. And when I prayed, I asked God, you know, to heal. I asked God, Pastor, you know, to raise this young lady up. I didn't know better. But when I finished the prayer and we were leaving, the elder said, Pastor, do you know what you prayed for? Pastor, do you know this person is on their deathbed? Pastor, do you know we have the coffin already prepared? We're talking about the power of God. Soon after, this young lady got up and started walking. But I remembered saying to her, when God raised you up, make sure you find yourself in church. Make sure you find yourself in church. Sister Wax, good to see you. I didn't see you in the beginning, but God bless on your son. But a week passed, walking up and down and passing the church street, and never appeared in church. And week two, and a month, she was okay, but after she fell sick and she died. But we're talking about that stone that is able to heal. With his stripes, we are healed. And today, you can experience even your own healing because Jesus is here. Amen. The Lord is here. He wants you to understand that he is still that stone. That stone that declared that I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes on me, he will live and he will not die. What a God that we serve. I pull this together here by letting you know here that for other foundation can no man lay, the Bible says, which is Christ Jesus. No other foundation. It's not money. Hello. It's not prestige and fame. But it is Christ Jesus. Are we together? Oh, 1 Corinthians says this in chapter 3, verse 11 to 15. And I love it. Because the Message Bible puts it this way. He says here, let each carpenter who comes on the job take care to build on the foundation. Take care. to build on the foundation. Remember, there is only one foundation. The one already laid. Jesus Christ. Take care in picking out your building materials. Take care. Eventually, there is going to be an inspection. And if you use cheap or inferior materials, you will be found out. The inspection will be thorough and rigorous. You won't get it or get by with a thing if your work passes inspection, fine. But if it doesn't, then my friends, you are in serious problems. It will be torn down. Paul, with conviction, said in Ephesians 4 and verse 14, then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of doctrine. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so cleverly they sound like truth. Counsels to the church that we are to be careful, because we understand that the devil is against the church of the living God. We understand that the devil hates the church, and he hates the church because the church is built on Christ, the foundation, the sure foundation. The one the Revelation 12:17 says, and the dragon was wroth. And he was wroth with whom? The woman. And went to do what? We know it very well. Make war with whom? The rest of his children. Who keeps what? The commandments of God. And hold to the testimony of Jesus. What foundation it is? Solid foundation. A sure foundation. But I want to share something with you here quickly. That foundation, Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul says that foundation bears a seal. It bears a seal. It bears a seal. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 19, you can take it down. The Bible says, but God's firm foundation stands, bearing this seal. What is the seal, Paul, you are talking about, that this church that is built on the foundation has? He says here, but God's firm foundation stands bearing this seal. The Lord knows the Lord knows those who are his. And let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. I believe it's a call that God is making to the church. That yes, the church is built on this sure foundation. But be careful and be mindful that those who are part of the church, you've got to remember that the Lord knows who are his. I don't know about you, but I'm happy to know that God knows those who belong to him. Aren't you happy for that? That in a world when people tells us that everybody seems to be doing wrong. Oh, some believe that they want to clean the church now. But we must understand that the wheat and the tares, they will grow together. Am I talking truth? Jesus will do his own cleansing. But we must understand that there are Christians in the church of the living God. And the Bible says that they are represented in such a way that the Lord knows them. And then those that he knows, they will depart from iniquity. One reason why the church must live right. One reason that you've got to assess your spiritual life. One reason that you've got to say, Lord, here am I. What's wrong with me? And when God points out what's wrong with you, say, Lord, change me. Some of us are too puffed up. Hello. Some of us are too filled with pride. That when God says, here you are, this is you. We blame others. We blame the church. But God wants us to understand that as we come face to face with him, we see our mistakes, we see our faults, and we cry out to him for help. Am I talking truth? My friends, Moses had issues. Moses had problems. And even with one of the problems that he faced, we know for sure he didn't make it to the earthly Canaan. We know that, right? But if you read the account very well, you would discover that at his death, there was a struggle. The devil and God had a conversation. Or the devil accused Moses of not listening to your voice, of doing his own business. Lord, God, well, he didn't say Lord, but God, you even said that he will not enter the earthly Canaan. He will not. He can only see it. Then something must have been wrong with his character. Something wrong with him. How can the Christian do wrong and you say he's right? Well, let me say, God must have declared, well, I'm not saying that he's right, but I want you to understand your accusations may be true about him, but because of my son's blood, because of my son's blood, he's covered in the name of Jesus. Let me say something to you. You struggle. We struggle from time to time as Christians. We face our battles in life. It's hard for some of us. For some of us, we have to, with tears in our eyes, cry out to God for help. Am I talking truth? Some of us, we struggle with problems. We struggle with issues. We have marital problems. We have children problems. We have work problems. Some of us can't even pay our bills. But understand that yes, the devil may seemingly have in his own way, but God has the final say. Tell somebody next to you, God has the final say. He has the final say on your life. I'm talking to some visitor here. God has the final say on your life. You may be struggling, but God can make it right. You may feel weak, but God can make you strong. Life may seem hopeless, but God can change your situation around. He can do it. I believe it with all my heart. The God that we serve is powerful. He's able. So E.G. White says this. The church in feeble and defective, though it be, is the only object on earth on which Christ bestows his supreme regard. He is constantly watching it with solicitude and is strengthening it by his spirit. Oh, what a God we serve. What a wonderful God. And the church that I'm part of is built on Christ, and we hold on to the tenets of truth as in the word of God, irrespective of what people may say. A matter of fact, they find problems with every doctrinal belief, everyone. But I believe on the authority of God's word that our Lord will come, and he will come soon. I still believe that the Sabbath is still binding. I believe it, like many of you, that the Ten Commandments still represents the character of God, and God calls for obedience. I still believe that. Yeah, the sanctuary truth. I still believe that. I believe that when a man dies, he's really dead, you know. He's really dead.
one of my uncles said to me, you're not passing to see the grave. I said, passing to see what? The grave? Man, I may go to graveside by not passing to see the grave. But do you know that some of us believe that? But I still believe when a man dies, he's real dead, you know? And he has no dealing with the affairs of this life. I still believe in the Trinity. Yes, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I visited once a funeral service. And while it may not necessarily be truth, what was being preached by this preacher, but when he stood up to preach, he said, Pastor, some of you are wondering why we do certain things in church. And that's a Catholic church. Why some of you believe or wonder why we do certain things in church? And he went about explaining everything, even to the sacraments and all those things. This is why we do it. I wonder why Adventists are afraid of saying, Thus saith the Lord. What is wrong that we cannot stand by and stand for Christ and somehow proclaim those pillars of truth? What are we afraid of? Don't we understand that the church is built on that sure foundation? Christ. It's built on Christ. My friends, as I close this message, I want you to know that truly the church militant will become the church triumphant. Hello? It's a battle now, but our victory will come. It's a time for tears, but our joy will come. It's trouble now, but peace will come. Our Revelation says, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth has passed away. And the sea is no more. And I saw the new city, holy city, the new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven. From God prepared as a bride adorned for a woman, or for a husband, sorry. Oh, the song says, John saw a glimpse, a glimpse of the golden crown. And the song says, tell us about it. Around the throne, he saw a crystal sea. Oh, there's got to be more. What will it be? I want to go to that city he saw. New Jerusalem, Jerusalem. I want to walk on your streets that are golden. And I want to run where the angels have trod. Oh, what a God we serve. I don't know about you, but I want to make it to heaven. I don't know about you, but I want to see my master's face. I don't know about you, but I'm fed up with this world. I don't know about you, but this world has too much trouble. I want to make it to heaven. What about you? Do you want to make it to heaven? Aren't you tired with this world? Aren't you tired with the troubles here? How many sleepless nights you have? How many times the tears flow? Aren't you tired? Aren't you weary? Let me tell somebody here this morning, your struggles may be real. And sometimes as Christians, we don't even understand the struggles of the person next to us. Because all we see is the nice clothes, the nice smile. But some of us, we smile and deep within our hearts, we are aching. I'm talking to somebody.
The pain is there. Leave your home to be here. And sometimes sad enough that we leave the same way. Jesus is saying something. He's speaking to somebody. You may have left the church, but God is saying it's time to come back. You may have made the excuses, but understand that I am still the foundation of the church. Stay on board. Stay on board. My friends, I was an AY leader of my church. Well, Sister Victor knows my church. But I became an AY leader at a very young age. From the age of 13, I said that I wanted to be a deacon. A deacon. Because somehow, the way that they operated, it got my attention. And I stepped into a church that I did not want to go in. And when I got there, I said, I want to be a deacon. Well, God allowed me to be a deacon the next year. And the following year, I became one of the AY leaders. And as the time goes by, I became a first elder of a church. Let me tell you something. The struggles are real, young people. The struggles are real, adults. We struggle. We try to make it. I remembered on my acceptance of Christ, Pastor. I used to say, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill. And somehow I still look to see, you know, if I'm falling short. But you know what I realized? That the doves and the doves and the doves shall not and the doves shall not disappear. And I just continue to live for Christ. Somebody say amen. I don't worry about the doves shall not. My life is in conformity with God's will. That's one. Two. Every Friday evening. Literally every Friday evening in my teenage years, yet an officer of the church. And I'm saying this to drive home an important point to some of us who are struggling but need to understand how God operates. And every Friday we go and play my football. Oh, how I love football. But somehow as sunset approaches, Pastor, the game got hotter, and I believe and I was convicted that I would score a goal before the sunset. And literally every Friday the sun would set and I would not score the goal. But then, like many of us today, I would walk down the road with my head down. Oh, you have failed again. You have failed. Tomorrow you will be in church and doing a program. But here you are. You have failed. I've prayed and prayed over and over. Lord, forgive me. At some point in my Christian experience, I felt the Lord wasn't hearing me. I said, Lord, how could you hear me and forgive me when every time I'm doing the same thing? God saw my heart. And one day, he said, son, get up. Here it is. If you want to stop playing on the Sabbath, it's Friday evening, then you can only do one thing. Don't play at all. And from that moment, a joy came into my heart. And I said, Lord, this is my commitment to you today. I will never play again on a Friday afternoon. I got the victory. Up to today, I have never played on a Friday, even with the boys on the slab at USC. Never. You can gain victory over your struggles. You can gain victory over your problems. But you've got to listen to the voice of God. And beyond listening is obedience. Will you obey the voice of God? Will you obey the voice of God? What are your struggles? The struggles that the pastor don't know about. The elder don't know about. But you know you are struggling. We pretend sometimes that all is well, but we know it's not all is well. But this morning, you can say, Lord, I surrender my all to you. How many of you want to say, Lord, I surrender my all to you? Just raise your hand, please. Yeah, just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. You surrender your all to Jesus. And if you so believe, why don't you stand, please? Stand, please. Stand, please. You surrender your all to Jesus. What a foundation the church is built on. The foundation of Christ. Of Christ. My appeal here is threefold. One. If you are here today and you have left the church, but you are here this morning and you want to say, Pastor, pray for me, I want you to raise your hand, please. You have left the church, but you want to say today, Pastor, pray for me. You have left the church, but you are here. I see one hand. Just raise it up. God be praised. One, two. Come, please. Just come. Just join me here. I want to pray for you. Come. Once you raise your hand, come, please. I want to pray for you. The next is this. You're not a baptized member of the church, but you've heard the voice of God. You're struggling. You're not a baptized member of the church. You've heard the voice of God. Just raise your hand, please. Not a baptized member of the church. You're not a baptized member of the church. You're not a baptized member of the church. You haven't been baptized yet. Just come, please. Just raise your hand and come. Just come. God bless you. Not been baptized, but you are here today. Not been baptized, but you are here today. You just come. Not been baptized, but you are here today. Come. We want to pray for you. God bless you. God bless you. Not been baptized, but you are here. Come. What about our children? All our boys and girls who have not been baptized, just raise your hand, please. All our boys and girls who are here who have not been baptized, raise your hand. God bless you. Come, please. We want to pray for you too. Just come. Just come. Come with him. God bless. Come, my friend. Come. Come. Yes, come. Come. Come, children. Come. 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 Sister Kelly, you could come too. If there's your boys and girls, I know you're taking care of boys and girls too. You can come support. That's nice. Yes, Sister Victor, come support our boys and girls. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. The last call, and then I give way to the pastor. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. The last. Oh, Lord is speaking to somebody, some child. God bless you, God. The Lord is speaking. You have failed, but God can do it. Do not leave this place without saying, Lord, I give you my all. Come, God bless you. Come, God bless you. Come, God bless you. Come, God bless you. The last is this. You are a visitor here today. You are a visitor. You're not a Seventh-day Adventist, but you are a visitor. This morning, we want to include you in that prayer. Yes, visitor. Special friend. Just come, please. Just come, please. Just come, please. If you are a visitor here, visitor visiting us today, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Pastor, I'm done. Thanks.
Somebody's coming? Yes. Beautiful. Beautiful. Lord, we have given opportunities to everybody here. How much you love us. How much you love your church. We have failed in so many ways, but today we want to recommit ourselves, Lord. Take our heart. Pastor, you have a mic? We want to pray this special prayer for you. The pastor's going to do this now.
God be praised. Let the church say, amen. Amen. I'm asking everyone to pray at this time. Pray at this time. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Dear Lord, we, thy believing people, come to you and thank you for the great grace that you have given through Jesus Christ. We thank you today for the word that has once again affirmed his victory and power in our lives. Lord, may we have the faith. Give us through your Holy Spirit the gift of faith that we may lay hold on your promise and your grace. We thank you for the word, strong, vibrant, that has pointed us to the sure foundation. And today, dear Lord, as we lay our feet on the sure foundation of Jesus Christ, we praise you, we thank you, we glorify you, Lord. And we ask that you will confirm every decision of faith here today. Amen?
Amen.
Confirm every life to the person of Jesus Christ, that the victory and the life of Christ may be ours. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Those who have come forward, we want to have a special continual prayer with you. And so I'm going to ask you to follow Brother Blenman. Follow Brother Blenman. Just follow him. Everyone. Even those who have come with them, follow Brother Blenman. And we're going to have a special season of prayer for you continually. Amen?
Amen.
Whatever your situation is, we are going to lift it before the Lord and keep it before the Lord until something happens. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Amen.
We're going to remain standing as we turn in our hymnals to number 306. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. 306.
I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith, and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Pure delight.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to be here yet another Sabbath day, whereby we can come and praise and worship you and fellowship with each other. We want to thank you for the word that we have heard today, and help that we will always try to establish that firm foundation in you, help that we will maintain that connection and that relationship with you as well, and that help that we can encourage others to do the same. As we leave this place, I pray that you will grant us your traveling mercies, and even as we go to the city today, I pray that you will prepare the hearts and the minds of those that we may encounter, and help that it will be a means of drawing someone closer to you, and that they can come next Sabbath and hear a word from you. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
You can be seated. We want to have a short meeting up front here with all the parents that are interested in their children joining the Adventure Club. We are restarting Adventures this afternoon from 3 o'clock, 3 to 4:30. All who are interested, we can be here for a short meeting immediately after church, which is now. Thank you.
Also, deacons and deaconesses, Pastor Morrissey is right over here. He just wants to say a word to you, a brief word, before we get into our lunchtime. Amen? The elder will give you some guidance with regards to what is transpiring this evening at this time. Go ahead, elder.
All right. So just briefly, the church, we are going down to town. We're going to combine with Amazing Grace this afternoon for singing band. Everybody heard? Singing band begins at 4. All right? So the church then has to already be in position. We will be in the operating in the area just opposite where AgriFest is. So we know we can situate ourselves there. You will see the Amazing Grace people. We will be there as well as good news. Now we need all hands on deck there. We'll be there for 4 and we will be going together, especially the youth. The youth will be participating in making sure that we get our collections together for the people who will be contributing. And of course, we need the senior youth as well, because you have the voices. Amen. We will be singing together. We will be soliciting people for their opportunity, giving them the opportunity to return to this great cause so that we can give to the master. So again, 4 p.m., singing band begins. We are with Amazing Grace, meeting in town, opposite AgriFest, right? The situation there, and then we will do that, okay? And again, there is lunch available. You will say a short prayer for that at the end here, and that's it, right?
And there's Bible study. A quick announcement, board meeting, board members, tomorrow, 4 o'clock, right here, in person. Thank you.
Praise the Lord, okay? Bible study with Ken and the elders at 2 p.m., so that's going to happen as well, all right? So I invite you to pause where you are just for a moment. We'll pray, say a quick prayer for the lunch, and then you can go on and be happy in Jesus, all right? Okay, so let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you will bless the food that has been prepared. We ask that you will be with everyone who is there. Let us do all things in decency and good order. And I pray that the food may be filling. Give us energy for our missionary activity this afternoon. And then I pray when we leave this place that you will go before us, keep us safe, and protect us as we represent you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One final thing I have for you. Brother Mon has asked the church members to see him. I believe he has some things that he would like to... Yes, some delectable delights. That's what we want to call them, right? That he would like to give to you. So all the church members, listen, I want to throw in some visitors there too. If you want to, just pass and see Brother Mon, you know? And we will get some stuff for you. God bless you real good in Jesus' name. Listen, greet somebody that you haven't seen. Make a friend. Listen, we heard today that friends are important. So make a new friend. Meet somebody. Talk to someone. Whatever you do, let God bless you as you leave, all right?